Thanks everyone for being here this afternoon to listen to me. I really appreciate. The topic of my talk this morning is saving chimpanzees at the edge. The outline of my talk will be to give you a bit of a background and tell you what the threats to chimpanzee conservation is, the reasons for hope, and what each one of us can do. We are located in Uganda. That's the map of Africa showing where Uganda is located. The small red dot is Uganda, and that's how Uganda looks like. Uganda is bordered by Southern Sudan in the northern part, Democratic Republic of Congo, eastern. In the southern part, we have Rwanda and Tanzania and Kenya on the eastern side. Sorry. Democratic Republic is on the western side. I work for a charity organization called the Chimpanzee Sanctuary and Wildlife Conservation Trust, which was established in 1998 to promote the understanding, appreciation, and conservation of chimpanzees and their habitat in particular, and wildlife in general. Chimpanzees, why chimpanzees? Chimpanzees are the closest living relatives to humans. We share 98.7% DNA similarity with chimpanzees. That is biologically. But socially, chimpanzees have, I should say from my experience, 100% social behavioral to humans. Chimpanzees are among the five great apes. We have the bonobos, who are sometimes referred to as the pygmy chimpanzees. And then we have the gorillas, we have the orangutans, and ourselves, the humans, a part of the great ape family. The term chimpanzees actually originates from a tribe in Democratic Republic of Congo, the Chiluba language, which means the monk man, and in Chiluba is Kivili Chimpanzee. The direct translation is monk man. The map in front of you shows the distribution of chimpanzees. We originally had chimpanzees in more than 21 countries. And the record is very clear. In the last 10 years, we have had 4 countries in Africa lost all their chimpanzees population, so they have gone extinct in those countries. And those are mainly in Western Africa. It is estimated that there are only about 150,000 chimpanzees left in the wild, and compared to over 1 million of them 100 years ago. So that is how much we have lost in the last 100 years. And we have done population census to establish exactly what number we have left in Uganda, and we have 5,000. So we feel privileged to be one of the countries that are still with this chimpanzee population in the wild. But also it puts a very big responsibility on us as a country to make sure that they are protected and they continue to survive. What are the threats? There are so many threats to the survival of chimpanzees in particular, and one of the biggest is bushmeat. There are certain tribes in Africa that actually eat primate meats, including chimpanzees. Especially the Central and Western African countries, they consider chimpanzee meat or gorilla meat, the primate meat, as a delicacy. So that is a big threat to the survival of chimpanzees. And at the same time, those are the countries where the chimpanzees are found, naturally. Man traps. Many times, a country like Uganda, we are lucky to have our culture not encourage the eating of primate meat, But at the same time, bushmeat is still one of the threats to other wildlife other than chimpanzees. So the common practice of getting the antelopes, the buffaloes, which are hunted by the Ugandans, is to put metal traps or wire snares in the forest, and this does not discriminate any animal. So the chimpanzees, the gorillas, and any other animals that the people might not be hunting still fall victims of these man traps and wire snares. This is an example of one of the juvenile chimpanzees in Kibale National Park who got his foot cut off from the wire snares. And we recently did a survey to try and find out how this is impacting the wild chimpanzee population in Uganda. When we were carrying out this survey, out of every four wild chimpanzee that we saw, there was at least one with the missing limb. Either it's the hand or the foot, or they're actually dragging the snare with them. Habitat loss is another big threat to the chimpanzee's survival. The demand for timber, it's not limited to Uganda, it's international. And because we still have the primary tropical rainforests existing, lots of demand of timber, for very good timber, is headed out to East Africa and Democratic Republic, where there's still plenty of the forest. But this is not going to take long before we get all of them gone. Because in Uganda right now, we are losing 92,000 hectares of primary rainforest every year. And from the coverage of the forest that is left in Uganda, it's only another 10 years, then everything will be gone. The habitat loss is also is happening due to demand for agricultural land and settlement. The Ugandan population has drastically gone up in the last 10 years. We have over 50% of the human population in Uganda below 15 years. And this feels like our problem with environment and wildlife is just at the start of it. Another threat to the chimpanzees is pet trade. There seems to be a big international network with people who are illegally dealing in live baby chimpanzees and promoting them as good pets. And we have a number of baby chimpanzees that are being traded. But what does it actually take, to get a baby chimpanzee out of the forest? Chimpanzees are very territorial animals, very social animals, like I said before, as humans are. So they live in a social grouping called community. So for each community, they get to know each member of the community and they protect each other. A mother chimpanzee and the baby are the special members of the group. They will always be protected by the rest of the members. And the chimpanzee community, they also have an hierarchical system. There's always, the boss of the group, that is the alpha male, and there are different ranking positions of each member in the group. And when there's any danger to any member of the community, the mother and the baby will always be the priority to be located, to find out where they are, and then they will have to be protected by the rest of the members. So if there's any trouble of people trying to get a baby chimpanzee, the other adults will try and protect the baby. And that would mean that no human will just walk into the forest, how strong you might be, and try and take away a baby chimpanzee from the mother. That would never happen. So to get a baby chimpanzee out of the forest, normally they would use guns. So they will have to shoot all the adults who are trying to protect the mother and the baby. And a mother chimpanzee is very, very responsible that she will never give up her baby, including her own life. She will have to be killed before her baby is taken out of the forest. So we are 100% sure that for every baby chimpanzee that gets out of the forest, the mother has been killed, and an estimate of 10, you know, 7 to 10 other adult chimpanzees would have been killed. That's an estimate. It could be even more, depending on actually how big the community is, because the more members there are in the community, the more the adults will try and protect the mother and the baby. The average community group is 40 to 50 members, but in Uganda we have done surveys and we have found communities of up to 120 members in one community. So if it happens in such a community, more adults would be killed in the process. This is an example of two of the chimpanzees that we got rescued at the airport on their way to Europe. Another big threat is the culture. Traditional medicine puts demand on the lives of the chimpanzees. In some cultures, right in Uganda, there is a belief that certain body parts of the chimpanzees provide healing for different kinds of diseases. So we see situations whereby chimpanzees are killed, and these are mainly the adults. The adults are the ones who are hunted for this. And when they are killed, it's mainly the hands, the feet that are taken off, and then the head. The rest of the body is thrown away to the vulture. And our experience has also been that most of these are actually the mothers who are killed. And the ones that we have come across, we find babies left by themselves because the mother has been killed. Rutoto is one of those cases. Rutoto is one of the chimpanzees we have at the sanctuary that has gone through this. There's also a big problem with some of the factors that I have already mentioned, with habitat loss. It's creating even a more complicated scenario whereby the animals' habitat are becoming less and less. There's not enough food for them to eat. And so next door to the forest, people are cultivating, so they end up going out to eat the crops. And this is creating a lot of conflict between the people and the chimpanzees. And what we are coming across all the time is people are being injured. Yeah, like the baby in the photo there was actually 2 months ago injured by one of the chimpanzees. But why did it actually happen? Yeah, the animal was only looking for food and went into this garden. And there was the mother of the baby who was cultivating. And when she saw the chimpanzee come out of the forest, then she made a lot of noise and gathered all the villagers who wanted to kill the chimpanzee. And the chimpanzee just acted in defense of his own life. And in the process, the baby was injured. But besides that, that has happened to the humans, but it's also happening to the chimpanzees. The photo of the hand of the chimpanzee there was purely as a result of crop raiding, where the chimpanzee went out just to look for food, because there's nothing, you know, the forest it's living in has become so small and there's not enough. So it went out, got a bit of the crops, and the villagers, you know, went after it, hunted it, killed it. And actually, this was not as a result of traditional medicine. This was just to show that, you know what, we are really not happy with the chimpanzees, and we have to make sure we kill them so that we don't have these problems. So as the charity I work for, like I said, the topic of my presentation is saving the chimpanzees at the edge. We have most of the chimpanzees in the protected areas, in the national parks, in the forest reserve, which the government is fully responsible and taking care of. But we did get this organization started to try and see where there was lack of protection of these endangered species. So we did get a sanctuary set up for the orphaned rescued chimpanzees, and that is on Gamba Island, which is an island on Lake Victoria. Lake Victoria is the second biggest freshwater lake in the world. And we have the island with 100 acres of rainforest, so we are providing a home for the rescued chimpanzees on this island. And besides that, the map on the right shows you the dark green patches are the forests that are protected as national parks or wildlife forest reserve. If we again go back into history, 100 years ago, this whole block of area was just dark green. It was one big block of forest, which is no more. There are just patches of them left. But also because of the scale of the map, in between we have some other small patches of forest that are on private land, and these are the ones that are really at the biggest risk right now. And those are the ones we are trying to work with to protect. Those are all the sad things to say of what is happening, but I do believe there is hope. There is hope. Each one of us can do something. As Chimpanzee Sanctuary and Wildlife Conservation Trust, as a charity organization, we are trying our best to see what we can do as Ugandans in the country where these animals are. So we have set up the sanctuary where we are providing a home for the rescued one. We are providing a home where they have a forest. When they are rescued, we rehabilitate them. Most times, they are really in very bad health conditions by the time we get them. They have been rescued from circuses where some of them have been castrated. They have been rescued from airports. They have been rescued from people's homes, keeping them in very small, you know, cages. We have rescued some in transit, you know, as they're leaving, you know, where they have been rescued from heading somewhere, you know. And we actually have four of them that were rescued at Milan Airport in Italy, and they were traced with the help of Dr. Jane Goodall. We got them returned back to Uganda because all the documentation did indicate that they were from Uganda. We also had an Egyptian circus, you know, and we found four of them as well were chimpanzees that were taken from Uganda. And again, with the help of Dr. Jane Goodall and other people, we also got them returned back to Uganda. And those are the members that we have at Ngamba Island Chimpanzee Sanctuary. At the sanctuary, right now we have 48 of these orphaned rescued chimpanzees that we take care of. Like I said, they come in really very bad physical condition. We do start by rehabilitating their health, but so psychologically they come when they are totally traumatized at different levels. And that is something else that we have to deal with as a second step. And as mentioned before, chimpanzees live in a social grouping. And for a chimpanzee to be taken away from a group and put in a cage, it's like taking a human being and putting him or her in prison, you know? Four walls, stay there. That's what it equates to. And what we try to do is, at Ngamba Island, we provide the opportunity for them to once again live in a social grouping. It is quite a challenging process to get this happen, but we are happy to note that, you know, over the years that we have been able to make this happen. So with the 48 chimpanzees that we have right now, 42 of them are fully integrated, and they all recognize each other as family, and they have set up their own hierarchy now within that. And each of them are coming from different places. Yeah, and this gives us hope that if we can set up places like this, these individuals can still have a chance to survive and live a normal life again. And in the process, what we do normally is we start the integration process from the indoor facility. We have different facilities at the sanctuary. So we start by introducing the new arrival to the rest of the group one by one, up to a point when we are confident enough that this individual has been fully accepted by the rest. And then it's also a process to get them to actually learn to live in the forest once again. We also do research on them, and we are trying to use this research information to get, you know, publications made to educate everybody about what values these animals have for us as humans. We do provide, we have established ecotourism services, so we actually have tented accommodation. Our visitors can come and spend time with us. You can come and volunteer. We always need the extra pair of hands every moment. We work with a very basic number of staff, and there's always a lot of work to get done. We use the opportunity of people coming to the sanctuary to educate them. So we make sure for every visitor who gets to the sanctuary that there's a message that they take along with them. So we try to use the sanctuary as an educational tool as well. And we work with the local communities that live on the neighboring islands, Tungamba Island too. Another reason for hope, this again is very specific to the sanctuary. I've picked up a few of the chimpanzees that we have just to show you where they're coming from. I mean, that's one of the individuals we have. She's called Aikuru. That's what she looked like in 2001. Look at where she is today. And Aikuru has a very, very sad history that the mother actually died in a forest fire in Congo. And a Ugandan soldier who was on duty took pity on her and brought her back to Uganda and surrendered her to the Wildlife Authority, and she was brought to the sanctuary. This photo was taken a little bit, you know, later on, you know, not at the actual time when she came. She had no hair on her, and she was so traumatized. She was malnourished, and she looked really, really bad. She was always so scared of people. Over time, she learned to eat well. She was growing well, but psychologically, she still had the trauma with her. And we got to know that every time she starts rocking, she's actually, you know, all the memories of what happened to her comes back to her. And when she starts rocking, then she can't eat. Then she just stays in one place. She will not move. And this, we got Aikuru brought to the sanctuary in 2001, and this habit continued. And it is only until 2 years ago that she overcame this. So it took so many years, and it gives us hope that, you know, it is possible. With some, it will take more years. With some, it will take less. This is another example. Connie, that's what she looks like when she came in 1992. Look at what she is today. She's one of the top ranking females in the community. And Connie is a very motherly individual. She's so sweet. She has, you know, she has a motherly character that every new baby chimpanzees brought at the sanctuary, she's one of the few who will get to adopt them. Sarah, whom you saw on the first slide, has been adopted by Connie, and they are just good friends. And Sarah, right now, after spending about a year at the sanctuary, does not care. She knows that she has a mother now. She's so comfortable, and it has totally changed her life. That's Naku. That's what she looked like, with big, you know, with the pot belly, malnourished. The hair is not looking healthy at all. That's what she looks today. That's Sarah on arrival. Sarah is one of the new ones. She was rescued in July 2012. She came to the sanctuary last year, you know, and today, look at her smiley, bright face. There she is with Connie, her adopted mother. So happy, and she's fully protected, you know. None of the others can try and put a finger on her. You know, Connie will jump up on them. What's the other reason for hope? We are also carrying out environmental education. We think that it is very important to have people understand. Sometimes we have discovered that some of the local Ugandan people are acting out of ignorance. So for that reason, we need to get them educated, aware about the values of this wildlife and the natural resources that they have. So music, dance, and drama is one of the tools that we use to get the people educated. So we work with school groups and get them to make performances with, you know, with wildlife environmental themes to try and get everybody educated. We have, with the support of different partners and individuals, we have been able to build some education centers around the country, and we reach out to different communities, not only children, but also the adults. Tree planting, I mentioned earlier, 92,000 hectares of natural forests are being cleared every year, and the opportunity is that, you know, if for the trees that are being cut down, if more is planted, then there should be sustainability with it. But we get the local communities involved also to try and cut down on their consumption of wood for energy. So we have introduced energy efficient stove for them. So we get them to use local materials to build this. Exhibition, we go out to different places and, you know, provide information, we provide educational material to get people to understand more. The one other thing is that we also have, we have some cultures within Uganda that actually promote conservation, but we are getting to lose it because now that we have formal education, the elders and the parents are giving up their responsibility of passing on the cultural values to their children. So they're like, you know, the children are getting everything in schools, but we are saying this is wrong. You know, we need to maintain the good culture. Some of them are bad, you know, like the traditional medicine. We would not want to encourage that, but some of them are good. Example, we have a culture where there are different clans and each clan has either a plant or an animal, you know, as their totem. So if you belong to a particular clan, say for example, you belong to a clan of the rhinos, you are charged as a community member to do everything it takes to protect the rhino. So it's a good thing. Some of the cultures, another totally different tribe, when a woman gives birth, there's specific tree species, indigenous species, that they have to plant during the naming ceremony. If it is a boy is named after three days of being born. A girl is named after 4 days of being born. And during the naming ceremony, the mother, the father of the child, and all the relatives have to get involved in planting trees, which has been a very good culture of ensuring that the trees, the forest continue to be there. This is dying out, but it's one thing that we are trying to do to make sure we do not lose this good value. Habitat monitoring and conservation. We have also set up a program where we are trying to monitor and see what is happening. We used to have lots of snares being put in the forest, you know, to catch the antelopes and the other wildlife for food. But we have specifically on this set up a project where we are working with the local communities. We have got a team of 25 young men who are very enthusiastic. They have dropped out of school because they can't afford it, but they are really committed to wildlife conservation. And thanks to Blank Park Zoo, because they have been able to partner with us. I met Jesse Laurie, who works with Blank Park Zoo, in a conference in Seattle 2 years ago. And we have created partnerships, so Blank Park Zoo has been able to provide the field gears that these guys are using. They were really working under very, very tough conditions. And Blank Park Zoo provided money that we use for buying bicycles to make it easy for their transportation. Jesse came with their mom to Uganda last year and brought, you know, 10 big boxes of field gears, from GPS to cameras, digital cameras, to, you know, to boots, to pants, and, you know, shirts. And these guys are just their own kings in their villages because of those things now. And that has even given them more motivation, you know, to do what they are doing, to help educate their own peers in the villages on the importance of protecting the forest. They help to advocate for everyone planting trees, for every, you know, trees they are cutting to use for timber or for wood fuel. They make sure that they tell their village mates, you must plant more. You're not just going to use and not have them replaced. That is really going a long way to help us with the work that we are doing. And we think that gives us hope. If we have people like this, 25, they are covering hundreds and hundreds of, you know, of miles, you know, that they have to travel, you know, in between the different patches of forest. If 24 young, you know, men and women in Uganda can do that, then we can really have hope, you know, that there is a future, as much as we have all these threats and challenges. The tree planting, and one other thing as part of this project is we have also set up a project where we are trying to see paying the landowners who have natural forests with endangered species like chimpanzees. Can they be motivated to leave the forest standing if they get some cash payment? Because it's also a practical, it's a reality here. All that these people have are the natural resources around them, the forest, the land, and they have to depend on this. So if you have to tell them not to cut down the trees and protect the wild animals, the question is, how do I feed my children? How do I get them educated? How do I get them to, you know, have a life? Yeah, and so they need to have an alternative means of surviving, of livelihood. So we have tried, we are right now trying out a project where we got a grant for, and we have made a calculation based on the international carbon trade, you know, payment. We are paying them equivalent of $28 for an acre of forest per year, $28 per acre per year. And that has helped us to save close to 1,500 hectares of natural forest in the last 2 years. And we are getting a lot of calls from others who are saying, what about us? I also would like to get that so that I don't have to cut down my forest and have it converted to agricultural land. We get the women involved in handicraft, yeah, so that they can have alternative. They do make jewelry out of recycled papers, and that is all in the hope that we will be able to recycle the papers and not cause, you know, damage to the environment with the papers being thrown all over, but providing, most importantly, providing a livelihood for the people. So, lastly, to finish, how can each one of you here be part of what we are doing? Would encourage you, one, to learn more about chimpanzees and the endangered species and educate the rest. Yeah, I'm sure some of your friends and relatives out there do not know some of these facts, and it would be nice for you to, you know, to be part of this and advocate and create this awareness. Two, write to your policymakers to support the conservation effort. Thanks to the US president who recently made announcement on his trip in Africa of the US government, you know, going to support the illegal wildlife trade. Those are the pressures coming from individual citizens like you. Do more of that. Advocate for your policymakers to provide budgets to environmental projects. And also, very specific to great apes and chimpanzees, yeah? There are some of the states' laws that actually do not forbid usage of chimpanzees, you know, in biomedical laboratories, as pet trades. So you can be part of, you know, you can be part of the advocate for this to make sure that these policies and laws are passed. Do not purchase wood materials derived from equatorial forests. Yeah? Yes, it's a way by which people are earning a living by cutting down the trees and carving them, you know, for different kinds of merchandises, but they do not, the benefits do not outweigh when the trees remain standing. So always ask where are these materials from? If they're from the equatorial region in Africa, please, I would encourage you not to buy those because it only encourages the cutting down of these forests. For those, you know, the social media is a big thing these days. We have Ngamba Island on Facebook. Please like us and visit us at Ngamba Island. I said we have tourism facilities. You can come and volunteer, and we have all the information on our website, www.ngambaisland.org. You can also make, you know, cash donation online. If you go to the same website, you can be able to do that. You can adopt any of the chimpanzees, Naku, Aikuru, or Sarah, and make a contribution towards her upkeep. And you can do that online as well. And you could also consider maybe making the contribution towards, you know, the forest conservation by paying, you know, $28 per year to conserve 1 acre of forest. To make it easy, partner with Blank Park Zoo because they are our contact, you know, organization in Iowa now. And any supplies that you might not need, from camera equipment to, you know, clothing, they have our list of what our needs are. And you can get it easily, you know, we can easily get that organized through them because now they know what it takes to ship the things to Africa. But also very important, I want to mention that the work we are doing is in partnership with Dr. Jane Goodall, who is synonymous to chimpanzees. And she has done a great job to get the plight of chimpanzees highlighted, and everybody has got to be aware about this. So she got the Jane Goodall Institute established. We do work in partnership with the Jane Goodall Institute. She has her main program now, Roots and Shoots, you know, which is basically to do with environmental education. And she's one of our trustees, so the Jane Goodall Institute has a representation on our board. I would like to appreciate Blank Park Zoo that has made this link possible. If Blank Park Zoo didn't send Jesse to Seattle to the ZAC conference 2 years ago, we would not have met. So appreciation to Blank Park Zoo, and also it's Blank Park Zoo that actually sponsored my coming to Iowa on this trip. So thank you very much. And personally as well, Jesse Laurie, who is right here, I mean, without you, this would not have all happened. Patty and Steve Weeks, I mean, I've been in your house. They're still hosting me. They have been driving me all over the place. This would not have been possible without you. Thank you very much. Gail, thanks for arranging this meeting today. I really, really appreciate. May you all be blessed. In Africa, the common language is Kiswahili, widely spoken in different parts, countries in Africa, but especially East Africa, we say Asante Sana. Thank you very, very much. And please, Sarah is saying, come visit me. I'm at Ngamba Island in Uganda. Bless you all. Maybe if there's any questions. Not very much, just a little, not very much.
I don't think they have chimps there, I guess.
No, they do not have chimpanzees, and many times I think their concentration has been working and partnering with the bonobo partners in Congo. Yeah. The island is only 100 acres, so the space is really limited. Yeah, so we have put all the females on contraceptive implants so that we can provide the space only for those who really need it. Because otherwise we run out of space so fast, and for those who need it, they won't have the place. But having said that, we know that sometimes the contraceptive implants also do fail. So we had one failure, so we have one that was born there. She's called Surprise. She's a little princess. She knows herself. She knows that she has her natural mother with her, her father there. So she really acts like a princess, and sometimes she's really naughty, that she actually will just go and cause trouble for the big males. You know, she'll go and sit near them and knock them, and then she goes like, ah, yelling, and every other one will come and just bounce on that male and beat him up. So with time, you know, all the adults have learned. So if Surprise is coming around you, be careful, because she could just be trying to cause trouble to you. Yes, the reason I have explained the reason why we are doing this, not encouraging reproduction at the sanctuary, but also long term we plan that we might be able to take some of the chimps at the sanctuary actually back to the wild. So right now we're in the process of looking for forests where we can get some of them. Some of them we know can never be able to live out there on their own due to the level of trauma they went through, due to the amount of time they spent in captivity. We still struggle with some individuals, You know, we take them on a walk in the forest at the island. Some of them cannot just climb the trees. We have to teach them to climb the trees. I mean, by the time a primate is failing to climb the tree, you know, they have gone through some serious, you know, things, you know, and trauma. So it's part of what we do with them, to try and get them really to get back to their natural way of life in the forest. Yeah, that's quite a good question. It's as a charity, we are depending on donations and grants from different partners, but that is never sustainable. And we always have to look for some other ways of making the money. And we have been able to set up the ecotourism facility so that people can actually be able to come and have the real experience. And also from that, when one travels all the way and gets to see what is happening, their level of appreciation is always higher than somebody who just watches, you know, on TV or a documentary, you know, about the program. And this has been a good source of, you know, income for the project. It has been able to get us to have the money that we need to feed them, because the forest does not have enough. The amount of forest, if we have to leave the chimpanzees to feed on their own, we would only need two of them. But we have 48 of them. So we have to supplement. What is in the forest is not adequate to sustain them. So we supplement their feeding. We do provide veterinary care to them. In the wild, chimpanzees do know how to medicate themselves. Yeah, they know which plant to go for. Before I started working for the sanctuary, I was working with the chimpanzees in the wild, and I witnessed this, where, you know, we got into a big, you know, group that had a big fight over their territory, and one adult chimpanzee, you know, made a big bite on the arm of the other one. And really, it was a big cut on the arm, and blood was just oozing out. And we saw the injured one move around, looking for a particular type of plant. And once he got the plant, he got lots of the leaves and crushed it and squeezed in the juice and put in there and plastered in, and there was no more, you know, bleeding. Yeah, they do medicate themselves. So we do, the sanctuary doesn't have all those species of medicinal plant for them. That's the reason why we have to provide the veterinary care. Now, back to tourism. You know, it's a, yeah, indeed, it's a thin line, you know, because if it is not properly done, then it can become an abuse. You know, it can equate to using the animals. But we are very, very careful about that as far as our project is concerned. It is strictly for the benefit of the animals. One very special experience that you would get if you visited our sanctuary is you would actually walk. You will have the possibility of being part of walking with the young chimpanzees in the forest. And because of being cautious about not passing the wrong message, we do not allow anybody to take photos when they're walking with the chimpanzees. And the experience when you're walking with them, they will want you to carry them on your back, and they will want to sit down and groom you, and you groom them. It's an experience that you have to carry with you, and it has to remain with you. You cannot show it out, because we do not allow that, for the reason that when people take these photos, they will go back home, show it to relatives and friends who have not gone through the experience, and it will totally be misunderstood if they see you grooming, a chimpanzee grooming you, and they will think it's so cool to have a baby chimpanzee as a pet, which is really what we are fighting. So that is how we try to draw the line, that the ecotourism should really be able to help the welfare and the conservation work, but not destroy it. Like I said, chimpanzees are 98.7% similar to humans biologically, and that makes it, they are susceptible to most of the diseases that affect humans, from tuberculosis to measles to polio to meningitis, yeah, all that. The common cold, flu, cough. We have had cases of in the wild with the wild population where we have had them coming out into the villages and they actually pick up the viruses, especially with measles in the villages, and then you find the whole group are affected. So we have to get them dated to ensure that it actually doesn't kill them. We have had some of them die of bronchitis because they have picked up these viruses from the neighboring villages, from the humans. So at the sanctuary, we are very, very careful about this. So all the staff and all the visitors have to have certain vaccinations because we work in close proximity, but also we interact with them so that everyone is protected. There are certain things that they have immunity to, some of the diseases like hepatitis A and B, because of the forest environment, they actually have immunity to that. So they would be the ones, you know, to transfer that to humans, not the other way around. But things like tuberculosis, they would get that from humans. And the cough and flu, yeah? So like at the sanctuary, once in a while, if we see any of them with flu, then we have to cover everybody with vitamin tablets. The lifespan, in the wild, they can live up to between 40 to 50 years, but in captivity, they can go up to 60 years and plus. No, we have never had any case at all, but also working with them in the forest is a rehabilitation process. So it's with individuals who are already orphaned. So they don't have their mothers with them. And we get to know them through the process as individuals with their characters and personalities. So if there's any who is very rough, you know, we try to get to teach them how to use the forest in a different way and we don't have to work with them. So we have never had any cases at all.
So much. This was just a great experience. We really appreciate you coming out today. Thanks.